Hey guys, it's Victor once again, and based on popular demand, I'll be giving essay tips for the MasterCard Foundation Scholarship at the University of Edinburgh in the United Kingdom. And I'll probably be doing a second part of this video. So this is the first part where I'll be taking care of the first three questions. There are actually five questions, so I do not want the video to be too long. So I'll be doing two videos. So this will take care of question 1, 2, 3. And the next video I release in few days will take care of question 4 and question 5. So before I proceed, I would like to put out a disclaimer. And it is that I never received nor applied for the MasterCard scholarship. So what I'm doing now is using my transferable essay skills or scholarship skills or scholarship tips. So tips I've used to get scholarships, other scholarships. I'm trying to use them to answer these questions to benefit those applying for the MasterCard scholarship. So I'm not talking as an alumni of the scholarship, but using just my, I think, the tips and tricks I have to address the questions. So I think that is very important to say. And then let's go straight into the questions, and I'll go straight into the tips actually. So question number one, I think I should read it out clearly. Reflect on your life so far. Tell us how you meet the key selection criteria of the scholarships program. You should include information on your academic achievements and barriers to education you have faced. So the word limit is between 50 words to 250 words. Not much if you ask me, but we could make gold out of nothing. So let's see, how do we approach this question? I think I came up with a simple format. It's just 250 words, so you have to hit the nail on the head. And why not begin by telling them about what you studied? So they want to know more about you, and they want to know the barriers you encountered in your academic journey. But it's just 250 words, as I said earlier. You cannot go back to probably your nursery school, your primary school, even secondary school. So I advise you start with your bachelor's degree. Yeah, so start with, I studied this or I studied that. So give them an insight to what you studied, the period you studied. So I studied philosophy between this year to this year. The name of your university, where it is located, the country it is located, since it's a multinational scholarship. So the name of your university, where it is located, what you studied, the duration you studied that course, and what you graduated with, probably a first class, a 2-1, a 2-2. Yeah, make it clear. Then tell them about the core modules you studied. For instance, I studied philosophy for undergrad. We did core modules like history of philosophy, metaphysics, epistemology, anthropology, sociopolitical philosophy. So I'll just give a list of these are the core modules we studied. And you could also add probably post-occupied in as a student and leader. Probably you are the secretary or the president or the vice president of the students group in your department. And another tip is to add probably the projects you undertook. So probably your final year project. You could see at the end of your course you were meant to submit a 10,000 word essay or a 10,000 word dissertation or project, and this was what your project was based on. Probably you worked on conflict management and language acquisition or something. You know, just look for something creative to tell them, this is the course I did, the university, this is the positions I occupied, these are the modules I did, this is the project I undertook, or projects, depending on you. It's just 250 words, as I said earlier. So I haven't told them about your background, your interests, what you did in school. You could just a sentence, what you're doing presently. So after graduation, I've been working as this. After graduation, I've been working as that. Just one line, doesn't have to be too long. Then you will move to the barriers of you encountered in your educational journey. And these barriers may be finance. You could say that you had to do a part-time job because you were not getting enough support from your family, probably because there were several mouths to feed, and your parents, by no fault of theirs, couldn't really assist enough. Or some people were even orphans, they had to sponsor themselves through school. It's also possible. So you probably had to take a part-time job or something, and you had to juggle a part-time job and studies, and at the end of the day, you came out victorious with a flying color. And it's important to add that part. So do not just tell them the sad story of how you struggled, how hard it was for you, but tell them how you triumphed. Everybody likes a victor. Yes, I'm not just saying this because my name is Victor, but I'm saying that everybody likes a hero. So do not just state the barrier and leave it there and try to appeal to pity, but show them how you were able to circumvent this barrier and do something great out of it. Like this example I gave, you're doing part-time jobs to raise money for your textbook for your fees. And at the end of the day, you still came out victorious in spite of the struggles and the inconveniences. Or it could be that your lab where you were working was not well equipped in your department. And what did you do? You have to go around collecting probably little cash here and there from students to buy things like a test tube, a petri dish, you know, microscope. Or you went to do some kind of a fundraising because the lab was not well equipped. And in spite of the poorly equipped lab in your university, you were still able to come out with flying colors and compete favorably with those that probably went to private universities. Or in spite of your poor equipment, you're still able to win a national project or a national competition or something. So just always, always try to include how you jumped over this hurdle. It is very important. So what next should you add? Then you say, yes, you appreciate, if there's still space anyway, it's just 250 words. You are appreciative of this opportunity to study in the UK. That you have a good background already and you've surmounted lots of challenges. So this will just be like a continuation of your trade of excellence, so to say. And yeah, that's the first, my tip on the first essay. So I probably put a bullet point or something to indicate the main points I highlighted. So I'll just mention them very quickly. What you studied, your bachelor's degree program, the duration of the bachelor's degree program, the university, the location, the core modules you did, the post you occupied in the student body if you were part of it, the projects you undertook, then probably your present occupation. Then you go to the challenges you face, whether it's financial, whether it's a poor lab, or probably even had problems with the faculty member because they were poorly paid and they were not invested in teaching you. So you probably had to do extra tutorials or something too. So you'll be able to compete with your pairs in other universities or something like that. So show them importantly how you circumvented this hurdle. So that is the first essay. So guys, for the second essay, I'll first read the question. We want to learn about your track record as a transformative leader. Tell us about one current idea or project you're working on, which clearly demonstrates this. Word limit as usual is 50 to 250 words. So there's something interesting they said here. They said idea or projects. So idea, something still in your head you're yet to implement, or project, something you've implemented already or you've already started implementing. So if you ask me, I'll tell you to focus on something you're already doing, not just something in your head, because I think it's more, it will put you on a better stead if you've already started working on that particular project. Another thing with ideas is that they can be quite idealistic because they're ideas, so not very realistic. So you might have beautiful things you want to do in your head, but they might be questionable because they are not realistic. And the reason why you've not done them in the first place might just be because they're not realistic. So if you want to focus on ideas, make sure they are practicable ideas, they are doable things. So I do not have a problem with you stating ideas you have, but I think I'll prefer, left to me, my own humble opinion, a project, something that is concrete, that you've started already or probably even finished. So I think that is a stronger case or a stronger compelling writing. That's something that is just inside your head. Yeah, that's just me. The second important point, there must be a community dimension of whatever project or idea you have. So it should be centered on giving back to the community, because this is about leadership. This is about leading others and providing services where there's a gap or where there's a problem, going there to solve problems. So it's about giving back to others. So if it's a project that just uplifts yourself for your own career advancement, that doesn't really directly affect the lives of other people, that might not meet the court. So it's better you concentrate on things that helped other people. For instance, you're in charge of, of teaching young girls about their sexual health, about their menses, giving, sharing them free sanitary pads and things like that. Probably you saw that there's a lot of teenage pregnancy in your community, and you decided to take up the task of educating young girls about their sexual and reproductive health. That's something laudable, if you ask me. So things that are altruistic, yeah, that's the word. Giving back to others, giving back to the society, not just yourself, because that is what I think the kind of leadership they are looking for. And whatever example you come up with, try to make them something scalable. In other words, something that could be improved upon or could be enlarged. Like the example I gave, a young lady teaching reproductive health to young girls, because she noticed that in this community that she works, lots of teenage pregnancies, girls do not know lots of things that they're supposed to know about their grooming and things like that. So, and now she's looking for how to enlarge this project. That's the scalability I'm talking about. Looking for ways to enlarge this to other communities, to other girls, those who stay out of school because of their monthly period, because they do not know how to manage this. So she's like, this is what I'm doing presently, and it's quite scalable, so I need collaborations, I need more assistance. This is the numbers of people I've already reached already, but it's something I wish to expand. And that brings me to my fourth point, collaboration. So you could say with this scholarship, I could collaborate with MasterCard or with other NGOs or with the government or with local individuals to expand this my particular project, because what I'm doing now is probably just from my own pockets and my budget is limited. So I'm looking for collaborators, other NGOs, government and non-governmental society, and even MasterCard to join me. So that's an interesting way of, you know, inviting MasterCard along with you in your journey to implement change and positive transformation. So I'll take the points again very slowly. First, I think I prefer concrete projects instead of ideas in the head. So, but if you insist on coming up with just an idea, make sure that it's quite realistic. So if it is a project that is beautiful, probably something you're doing presently or something you did probably in the past, recently, not so far away, and try to demonstrate the committee dimension, because it's about giving back, altruism. That's the word you should be looking forward to. Then scalability, that you wish to probably enlarge or to continue this project or to give it a new, you know, to revamp this project or something like that, or to add it to what you're doing already, or, you know, look for ways to show that this project is not over. It's something ongoing, it's something interesting, something people should get involved in. And that's why I brought a fourth point, collaboration. MasterCard, you can come and join me in doing this wonderful transformation. I'm also looking for other collaborations with other NGOs, with government and non-governmental organizations. And I think with this, you'll be able to write a compelling essay. So remember, it's just 250 words, so you have to go straight to the point. No definition, no I am a leader that is driven, show and not just tell. From the first sentence, you're already giving an instance. So even if you want to give probably a few lines of what leadership is, I think it's okay, but for me, you're wasting words already. So make it as brief as possible. Go straight to the instance, the particular thing, and show these points I told you about. And with that, I think you'd come up with something substantial. So the third question, guys. We aim to award MasterCard Foundation scholarships to individuals who benefits most from the opportunity. How would being a MasterCard Foundation Scholar at Edinburgh support your development? So this is a personal dimension of the scholarship. How is it going to affect you positively? So first, we could start with the Master's program, how it would equip you with analytical skills, furnish you with techniques, with strategies in your present field of specialization. You might say you presently work on probably green energy, probably work on, sustainable development, probably work on public management, public administration. but you notice that there's a skill gap and you want to fill this skill gap, and you see this scholarship as something that will help you with those skills and strategies to help you fill this skill gap you're talking about, and also lift you up professionally because you want to advance your career. You know there's a skill gap somewhere and you want to fill that skill gap. This scholarship will help you fill that gap and also advance you in your professional career. You could also say and mention finance, that you've always dreamed of studying in the top university in the world, and Edinburgh, there's a top university up there in the UK. And this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to elevate your professional profile and your academic profile. But unfortunately, I've always had this dream, but finance has always been the problem. So you see this MasterCard scholarship as a way of elevating you, your professional career, your academic career, even in your financial status, because they're also going to provide you with upkeep to take care of you while you're studying. So it's like a financial upliftment, a career upliftment, a professional upliftment. All these, of course, will lead to your own personal development. So you could also take advantage of the network. That is, you could collaborate with MasterCard on your projects, the projects you had, like the ones you've discussed earlier. You could mention them quickly. Or you could also take advantage of the vast MasterCard network, alumni network, to connect with people to see how you can collaborate on projects to bring positive change and to get connections for your own upliftment, probably to get a job, to get finances, you know, to raise funds for a particular project. But I think this is quite straight to the point, how it actually affects you. So one, you need this master's program or this master's degree to furnish you with skills, techniques, strategies to advance in your career development. So this master's scholarship as well will help you with finance. You've always dreamt of studying in the UK or abroad in the top university. It's a one-time, once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Finance has always been the problem. MasterCard has come to help. So they're coming to help you with your personal, academic, professional development. Then the network, MasterCard, is coming to widen your network. And you see chances of future collaboration with MasterCard itself and the vast alum community. And that's it, guys. I hope this wasn't too long. I hope it was worth it. And as I said earlier, I do not belong to the MasterCard alum community, but I'm trying to use knowledge from the scholarships I have received to try to answer these particular questions. So if you have questions you would like to ask that are not clarified here, I might not be the one you should ask. Probably you would look for a MasterCard alumni or a present student and ask those questions, because probably you need an insider information that I do not have. So I think I should put that down and put that out here and be direct about it. And that's it, guys. The second question, or was it? No, the fourth question and the fifth question. So we answered the first, second and third in this video. So the fourth and the fifth will be answered in the next video. So do not just want to prolong the video. Don't want it to be too long. The longer it becomes, the more tired you become and you might not get all the important points. So I'll leave that those two questions for the next video coming out in a few days. I think I would look at the questions, write down my thoughts and share them with you. So until next time, guys, keep writing, stay inspired, and something good is coming your way. Bye-bye.